kind to my mom. Oh, I'm doing it. Are we in charge of that right at 10 a.m.? Okay. Bring me back. My fix for all of that was just trying to lead by example and try to make music as accessible. Good music as accessible. People are more engaged, or people like it more when they're engaged. And to try to do.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Riverside Presbyterian Church. We're happy you're here on this Daylight Savings Day, my least favorite day of the year. Congratulations to all of you for remembering to set your clocks back. Whether you're here with us in person or joining us online, we're happy that you're worshiping with us, and we are going to continue that worship, so please stand as we sing some songs together. Thank you.
Please be seated. Again, it's good to see each of you here in worship today. I want to make two announcements. One is that we will be adjusting the music a little bit. You in the house and perhaps you online will not even notice that we're making adjustments, but there are copies of the worship bulletin floating around. So you may not have seen one. You may wonder how come you didn't get one. But there are copies of the worship bulletin floating around, and from that particular script, there are one or two changes musically because Diane can't be with us today. And so I don't think it'll cause any kind of difficulty for you because all the music is on the screen. Is that fair to say? All will be well. Okay. Second announcement is that a reminder to those of you who are involved in officer training, we will meet after worship today in Knox Hall for a talk it over session where we will discuss the material you heard or saw last week. And I hope you can join us for that immediately after worship. And unless the preacher gets too long-winded, we'll be out in plenty of time for lunch. So, officer training, immediately following worship this morning. The Lord is in this place. The psalmist referred to this as the holy temple. The Lord is wherever we gather. And in particular, when we gather for worship, we trust that God is with us. So we come to worship God, believing that God is in our midst. Let us worship God, and the peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to share the peace of Christ with those in the house. And if you are worshiping alone, share the peace of Christ with us by trusting God's power to carry your greeting across the way. If you're worshiping with someone else around the computer, then I hope you will pass the peace to those with whom you are worshiping. Amen.
Please let me Good morning. Please join me as we say and pray our prayer of confession. Gracious God, we rejoice when we remember that you love us, that you have embraced us as your own children, that you have set before us the way of righteousness and peace. But we confess that too often we have turned to the ways of this world. We have trusted in the power and prestige granted to us by human agencies. We have embraced the value of men. We have adopted the precepts of women. We have behaved as children of a lesser God. When we have been hurt, we have responded by hurting back. We have been better at excluding than including. We have been more concerned about our own rights than others' needs. God, forgive us. Set us free to live as you have taught us. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. And the assurance of forgiveness. The word of promise is that God is faithful, even when our hearts condemn us, especially when our hearts condemn us, even when we fall away from righteousness, especially when we fall away. God's promise revealed in Jesus Christ is that we shall be made whole. Thanks be to God. Amen. And please stand as we sing our next familiar hymn, Come Thou Almighty King.
That hymn. But we are going to sing a song.
Please continue standing.
Trimmed and mighty, keep our lamps trimmed and mighty, keep our lamps trimmed and mighty, for night's time is drawing.
Am I on? There you go. Come on down, guys. Who brought something today? No sack? Well, here comes a sack. Thank you, sir. Uh-oh. This is a friend of mine. How did they get him in the sack? In the sack is a long-eared yellow character. I'm going to touch him as little as possible. And do you guys all have stuffed animals? You know what's missing on this stuffed animal today? Come on, you can tell what's missing. Thank you, sir. Andy got it. He's not wearing a mask. So we need to put a mask on him somehow. You guys are very good about wearing your masks. And sometimes, as we talk about this crazy COVID thing, we get a little lazy about wearing our masks. And I hope you won't get lazy with your mask. I don't think it's too important to make masks for your stuffed animals. Did you all say you have stuffed animals? Anybody who doesn't? You know, one of the things that sometimes we think is that when you get to be an adult, you don't have any stuffed animal friends. If that's true, that is a shame. I'm sorry for you. You need a stuffed animal friend. Because what do you do with a stuffed animal? Hug your stuffed animal. That's good. And what else do you do? Cuddle. Do you talk to your stuffed animal? Uh-huh. And you say things like, hey, stuffed animal, what does this one have a name? Okay, you call it by name. You say, hey, guy, how are you? Why would you talk to a stuffed animal who can't talk back to you? You can imagine. Great. Can you all see the picture on the screen? You see how nice, how good you look? Now, what's wrong with that picture? You got it. Kylie got it. There's a bald man right in the front of the picture. There's something wrong with our technology when we can't show the faces of Fusion Youth without ruining it with a bald head. So I'm gonna challenge the AV crew, the technical wizards in our house, to figure out some way to splice me out of that picture. Anyway, when you talk to your animals, you can say, you can imagine that the stuffed animal is talking back to you. And the reason I ask that, and the reason I'm glad for the answer, is when we talk to God, how do we hear God talking back to us? Okay? Yes. God speaks to us through other people. We kind of imagine or figure out what God is saying because of the circumstances in life. Most people do not hear a big booming voice, hey guys, from God. Most of us hear the inner voice, what we call the inner voice of God speaking to us. And that typically comes out of our own thoughts, our own imaginings, our own relationships with other people. So here's a possibility, just a possibility, that I want you to entertain for today. God speaks to us in worship. In this hour when we're here, God probably has something to say to you. And I want you to pay attention. Will you do that? Will you listen? Okay, who's going to bring something next week? All of you volunteer at once. Okay, Kylie, let's pray. Let's pray. You're not going to be here next week. Well, now you are. Okay, we got you. You going to bring something? Is that what this means? Okay, we'll govern. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for bringing me to church to learn about you. Amen. Thanks, guys. See you next time. Will you join me in prayer? Loving God, we give you thanks today in the sure and certain confidence that you do speak to us, that we sometimes do not hear, sometimes we ignore, sometimes we grow because we've heard your word. We thank you for each reminder that we can speak to you, that we can hear your word to us in the circumstances of life and in the beauty of worship. Week after week, we invite you into our time together at the church. We open our hearts and make ourselves available to you. We pray that we will become the best version of the disciples you have called us to be as we seek to know your will, as we change things in our lives that are not helpful, as we become, as best we can, living examples of your love in the world, as we work together to carry out your mission, as we claim the joy you have imagined for human life, we rejoice that you are in our midst. Inspire us to new heights. Inspire in us a new affection for the life of faith. Show us how to be faithful in ways that are dynamic and engaging. Help us know how best to get involved in the life of our church and community. Make us hungry for your word, eager to be in fellowship with brothers and sisters, and committed to following your way in a world that offers so many other ways. Be with us, support us, engage with us, strengthen us, make us able. This prayer we make in Jesus' name, and we pray together as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to add to that prayer the prayer of thanksgiving to you for your generous giving, and a prayer of dedication so that what you give may do what you intend. Let us pray as we dedicate the offering. Gracious and loving God, we give through the writing of a check or the signing of a card or the click of a mouse so that something of what we have might be used for what you want us to do in this place. We are thankful for the opportunity to offer ourselves, and we do so in the sure and certain hope that what we give may further the work of the kingdom in this place. We thank you for each giver and for each gift. We dedicate them to your purposes in Jesus' name. Amen. I've told you, haven't I, that I can do that? But that's not my job. That's their job, so I don't, but I can do that. You know I can do that. Well, again, for those of you who may have not been tuned in to the Lenten series, let me remind you that our worship theme for the season is Discipleship Disciplines, Lessons for Lent. The proposition of this preaching series is that discipleship is a long-haul journey supported by the various disciplines we learn to nurture our belief in Jesus Christ and support us as we try to live His way in the world. These disciplines would include the obvious: prayer, Bible study, church participation, service in the world. But this series seeks to go beyond the first things we think of. One challenge to effective discipleship is recognizing that Christian values are often in opposition to the values of the world, and we have to learn how to live faithfully in that tension. Today's lesson from the Apostle Paul makes the point, and this is something with which you are very familiar, Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. Paul writes, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect." Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this good day. Help us do good with it. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. One of my early memories of the church is the preacher holding forth on the subject, the way of God and the way of the world. As I remember, it was at Hungry Creek Baptist Church in a place called Up the River, North Carolina. And I was there on a Sunday night with my sweetie. She was allowed to date on Sunday night, but the only place we could go was church. Can you imagine that today? Well, that's the way it was then. And so I was in church with my sweetie, and he was carrying on. And one of the things he said was, "The values of the world will lead you to perdition." I had no idea what perdition was or where it was, but I could tell by the tone of his voice I didn't want to go there. But what I most remember and what most troubled me at the time was that the message seemed to be saying that the world offers all the fun things and God is bringing the heavy stuff. And as a 16, 17-year-old, I'm thinking, things must be pretty bad for the preacher to make him so down on the world. I mean, I'm thinking, I just got my driver's license. I have a new set of drums. I'm in a rock and roll band. I have a job picking tomatoes on a truck farm. And I have a sweetie on my arm. Hey, the world ain't doing so bad by me. The only improvement I could think of was that maybe my sweetie would join the Presbyterian church. Now, as it's turned out, things haven't changed much since I became a man and put away childish things. Scripture is still saying, don't get sucked in by the world. And I'm still enjoying how good the world has been to me. So there. I've admitted my complicity. I know you, some of you anyway, think I'm a monk. But I'm not. I'm just like the rest of you, really. I've been sold down the same river. I'm in the same boat as you, living and enjoying the values of the world. And the discipline for Lent I want to call to your attention today is that we have to discipline ourselves to live in the midst of the values of the world and still manage to foster the values of God. Paul says, do not be conformed to the world. But of course, we are conformed to the world, all of us. That's the reality. That's the way it is. Christians living in this world, disciples of Jesus Christ living in this world, have to learn to live with the values of the world without compromising the values of God. That, again, is why I'm saying it takes discipline. That is tough. One of the first things I discovered when I moved to Florida is that you have to live with the alligators. When I was in North Carolina, it was bears. In Kentucky, it was horses. In New Jersey, it was automobiles. In Florida, we have to live with the alligators. They are in the parks, the lakes, the rivers, the retention ponds, and sometimes they're out on the street. A week after I moved to Florida, there was a picture in the local paper of an alligator found on the street in downtown Jacksonville. Alligators even come up to our doorbell, our doors, and ring the bell. I know that to be true. I saw it on the internet. And look at this, if you will. Can we get a picture? Can you see that alligator? How big would you say that gator is? Just that alligator, that picture was taken from my patio of my pond. It's probably 30 feet from my patio to the pond. I got a call from my next door neighbor who said, "There's someone fishing in your favorite spot." And so I went out to look, and this is what I found. And this is not, I don't know if you can tell it from the picture, but this is not what I call a pond gator. A pond gator is a little juvenile, 2 or 3 feet long, and they get in all the ponds, and the people have to come and take them away. This is not that. This is one of the big boys. This is an alligator that is a danger to pets, small children, and unwary fishermen. This picture and this alligator tells a story. It tells us, I think, that the problem of living with the values of the world are like the problems of living with alligators. You can take it down now, Karen, if you will. Alligators and the values of the world both become dangerous when we stop thinking of them as dangerous. That's what conforming to the world means. When we get so used to it, so comfortable with it, when we conform to the values of the world, both alligators and the values of the world become a problem for us when we get too comfortable around them. People who are cautious around alligators don't have too much trouble with alligators. And people who are cautious about the world's values are not going to be so completely conformed to the world's values. They're going to hold out in some ways. We have to live with the alligators, and we ignore them to our peril. We have to live with the world's values, but we don't have to let them determine the character and direction of our lives. Do not be conformed. Rather, Paul says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, this verse of Scripture has 2 or 3 places for us to preach. And one part of the preaching has to do with this renewing of your mind as a way of being transformed. And I want to put in a plug for the pastor's midweek messages. If you're reading the midweek messages for March, you know that I'm talking about renewing our minds, and I'm calling it thinking about our thinking. So I'm not going to preach that part today. I'm going to leave that for the midweek messages. Right now, I want to focus on the transformation itself, the transformation that comes with the renewing of our minds. I think Paul would describe this transformation as something like paying attention, just as we pay attention to the alligators. Careful consideration, a greater awareness. That's why Paul can speak of transformation as an activity of the mind. That's why Paul can lay out the prospect of being transformed as a choice. Christians disciples of Jesus Christ, children of God, believers, however we see ourselves, we are daily called to a new resolve, daily called to a renewed commitment to figure this out, to understand what it means to be in the world, but not of the world. That's a Bible verse that's tough. It's hard to work that out, but we're daily called to understand what that means, to be in the world, but not of the world, to live faithfully in the tension between God's way and the way of the world. Now, if Carolyn listens to this sermon, which she probably will, she's going to do this. You remember that? I told you before. That's Carolyn's expression for tell me more. What does that look like? Helen always wants to know what things look like. When I make a statement, I make a big preachment, she says, what does that look like? Well, admittedly, we don't really know what it looks like to be transformed. We don't really know fully what it means to be transformed. Some segments of the church have it all figured out, and they have a quick fix. They say, just accept Jesus and you'll be squeaky clean. I don't think that's so. My experience is when we accept Jesus, we began a battle. We began a journey. We began a process of transformation. I think of the church and the Christian life as a rough draft. I think of our experiences trying to understand the transformation, trying to understand the kingdom of God as a glimpse of what God has in mind for us. From the scriptures and from our life together, we can get glimpses of the world turned right side up. From time to time, we have experiences that cause us to say, aha! I like to say, we get aha glimpses. Aha glimpses. That's a good word combination. I looked it up in the North Carolina Dictionary of the English Language, and there it was. It was not in all dictionaries, but if you have a North Carolina dictionary of the English language, there would be aha glimpses. And then the definition says that a glimpse is a brief look, usually with the implication that there is more to come. And aha is an exclamation, which means that's what I'm talking about. Or now we're getting somewhere. Aha glimpses, a glimpse, and you say, now we're getting somewhere. Several years ago, I was privileged to be the preacher at the National Presbyterian Youth Conference in Montreat. Some of you will remember me talking about being the keynote speaker. Not so long ago, I brought a t-shirt that my son picked out for me to wear when I was to stand on the stage and talk to 1,200 teenagers. Well, that was keynote speaker. Preacher is a different job, and I was fortunate enough to be asked to be keynote speaker, and then several years later, I was invited back as the preacher. This happened the year I was the preacher. Every day, and this happened, I think, every youth conference, but at the lunch break, the conference leadership would sit in the rocking chairs on the porch overlooking the lake and make ourselves available to any of the kids who wanted to stop by and just chat. One day I asked a group of the kids to give me an example of an aha. One girl said, an aha is when you go out with a guy and he talks about you instead of himself. Do you see the definition working? Aha, now we're getting somewhere. He's talking about me instead of himself. That's what I think we can gather. A glimpse, an aha glimpse. Here's another aha. An example of the aha, it seems to me, is critically important. This came from a note I received from a church member several years ago. My granddaughter, Amelia Grace, just turned 4 at the end of March. I taught her the hand moves to Here's the Church. You know that? And you put your fingers together and you stick your little fingers up as a steeple. And here's the church and here's the steeple. And you open the door and there are the people. Well, she taught that to her little granddaughter. Then she said, "My daughter said Amelia was doing Here's the Church this morning and then kissing all her fingers at the end." She asked her what she was doing. Amelia said, "I'm kissing all the people." Aha. You're going to get the glimpses. Carolyn, if you're listening, what does it look like? You're going to get the glimpses. You're going to get those aha glimpses of what transformation is all about. And we see these glimpses of God's transformation, but we still find ourselves conforming to the ways of the world. We are tempted to simply simplify this by pointing to the national scene and the latest hot-button issue and crying out, "Foul! Our nation has forsaken its Christian foundation." And that may be true, but it's too easy. I think Paul is referring to a conforming to the world that is far more basic, far more insidious. I don't think Paul is concerned about the latest issue being debated. I think he's referring to a worldview that captures us, and we let it capture us, and then we forget that it's dangerous. I think Paul is concerned that in our ordinary, everyday lives, the imprint of the world goes unnoticed. In those things that never make a blip on the screen, in those things that will never be debated by the politicians, the imprint of the world goes unnoticed, and that's how we conform. Let me give you an example. Designer clothes. What does that tell us about the imprint of the world? The original proposition is this. We have to live with the values of the world. There's no way of getting around it. It will be great if we could just magically stop conforming, but it's not going to happen. We have to live with the alligators. Our challenge is to live in the world of competing values and at the same time live according to and be transformed by the word and work of God. The world will always draw us into a certain conformity. The world will always imprint us. The question is, will the mind of Christ imprint us? Will the way of God imprint us also? Let me tell you one more alligator story. Years ago, before there was Tommy Hilfiger and Abercrombie and P. Diddy and whatever the shirt of choice is today, way back when, the shirt of choice was Izod Lacoste. Anyone here old enough or fashion conscious enough to remember Izod Lacoste? You can still get the shirts today if you go to one of the finer stores. And don't be fooled by a plain old Izod, which you can buy most anywhere. Walmart. That's not the same as Izod Lacoste. The distinguishing mark of an Izod Lacoste shirt is a little green alligator stitched onto the chest area of the shirt. Actually, it's a crocodile, and I know that. But this is a sermon about alligators. So we'll call it an alligator for today. Back in the day, everyone who was anyone wore Izod Lacoste shirts. They were the fashion statement of the day, and I didn't want to look like a total ignoramus. So I saved my money and bought a couple of those shirts. Now, I was engaged at the same time with the Montreat Youth Conference, and those people on the planning committee of the youth conference were cautioning the leadership about showing off their conformity to the world and said it would be good if you would refrain from wearing your designer clothes at the youth conference so as we don't set that model, that kind of leadership. Well, here I was with two nice shirts, and they both had alligators on them. So, I took a razor blade, and I very carefully cut the alligators off my shirt. I didn't damage the shirt. No, I didn't cut a hole in the shirt. But I was surprised to see that the imprint of the alligator was still visible. And the imprint was showing just as much as the alligator had. Clearly, I hadn't achieved anything by cutting up my clothes. The imprint of the alligator was still there. Now, what does that tell us? I think it tells us that the imprint of the world is going to always be there. So that the question always becomes, you can't, nonconformity, let's say it this way, nonconformity is not about trying to get rid of the world's influence. Nonconformity is not about cutting the alligators off your shirt. It's about living a life in the world where your witness bears a stronger testimony than the imprint of the world. It won't help to cut the alligators off our shirts. We will always bear the imprint of the world. The question is, to repeat myself, will we also bear the imprint of the cross? Don't be anxious about the imprint of the world. Just be disciplined to bear the imprint of the cross as well. Thanks for listening. Be the disciple Jesus has called you to be. And when you struggle with that responsibility, when you've done as much as you think you can do, when you've gone as far as you think you can go, when you've held your chin up as long as you think you possibly can, and you feel like quitting, don't do it. Just reach back a little farther, dig a little deeper, and do the best you can. Remember, God has never asked for anything but our best. And if we'll give God our best, God will gather up the best from each of us and change the world. Grace and peace to you this day and every day. Amen.
Say to my brothers and my brothers, keep the faith when the storm flies and the wind blows. Go on at a steady pace when the battle is fought and the victory is won. We can all shout together, we have overcome. We will talk to the Father and the Son, and we'll make it to the promised land. If we walk together, little children, we can make it to the promised land, make it to the promised land.